with BlackRock, Blackstone, Blackcube? Like, what is up with
this? Well, Blackstone and BlackRock are directly related. Steve Schwarzman from Blackstone basically gave the line of credit that created BlackRock, and they deliberately, Fink and Schwarzman talked about creating deliberately related names to confuse people.
Oh, okay. Wow. That they got it.
Yeah.
I need one of those line
and
of credits.
And then Blackcube is an admitted by Israeli media, mainstream media, to be a front company for Israeli intelligence.
Yeah, that's another thing that really spooks me out is the Krolls. The Krolls freak me out, just in general. Like, that you know about them.
They're running FTX bankruptcy stuff right now.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Dude, I don't like those guys.
They get brought in to cover up all sorts of stuff, the Krolls.
The other thing that disheartened me, like, I'm probably going to need you to talk me off the ledge come October, November. I'm not going to vote for Trump, I swear to God, but if I get bit by a Trump bug, just you have to explain this to me again. But the stuff with RFK and Maxwell and Epstein.
No, no. Mm-hmm. Yeah, no.
That stuff over. Hurts, too. Like, I was like, oh, fuck, maybe it's going to be RFK. He doesn't like the vaccines. He's against all this shit. And Spade's reading your book, and he tells me, oh, yeah, they were flying on Epstein's plane and shit, which he's admitting. Yes. So, like, what do you like, is it? Like,
I don't think it's, I think it's, he's a target in general. Like, I had so much hope for that dude until he was like, Gaza's the most pampered, whatever the fuck he said. Like,
wild
that, moves. That was a wild one, man. That was a wild one. I mean, it makes sense if you think blackmail exists.
Yeah. Was on heroin for a little while, so they might have got a few pictures of him.
I mean, he had a very, like, checkered past. They could have gotten anything. It didn't necessarily have to be Epstein's.
I got
plane.
A picture of him and Epstein, dude.
Yeah, they were seated at the same table at some gala together, and then after my book, I found out someone sent me a picture of him at Ghislaine Maxwell's apartment in, like, 2014, RFK solo. When I interviewed RFK about it, he said he basically blamed it all on his now-deceased then-wife,
Mary
Richardson.
Come on, that's a bad
dude, it's that Bill.
But
like,
there
it's
is
really
evidence
weird.
For her having been the link to Ghislaine before... RFK was on the flight logs and all of this stuff. So it does seem likely that, you know, he was introduced to them through her. But at that time, Ghislaine was deliberately targeting the Kennedys, not just RFK Jr. That's how she got invited to Kerry Kennedy's wedding to Andrew Cuomo. There's pictures of her flirting with RFK Jr.'s older brother in the early 90s.
She was hot for him.
Before she teams up with Epstein publicly in 91 after her father dies. And then after her father dies, she and Epstein are, like, you know, hanging around RFK Jr. and Mary Richardson, who was Kerry Kennedy's, like, best friend, like, roommate in college and stuff. That's how they teamed up. And Mary Richardson's boyfriend before RFK Jr. was this kind of spooky guy named Carlos Mavrolian, who's sort of like a Jamal Khashoggi-style guy, was, like, embedded with the Mujahideen and then, like, became a war correspondent, I think, for ABC. And then when there's all the setup of the Al-Qaeda boogeyman and the events before 9/11, like a few years before, a year or two before then, he gets, like, very clearly killed off by, like, either Pakistani intelligence, I think, a very obvious murder that was framed as a suicide.
You think he was like a CIA guy?
He's in Epstein's black book, and they're like a big shipping family, a Greek shipping family tied up with the mob, not unlike Jackie O's family, the Onassis family. And there's a few of these around. So
the Marvolian guy, you think he's like a CIA guy or like a mob guy? Or does it matter?
The guy that was a war correspondent that was dating Mary Richardson first.
Yeah.
I definitely think he was like an intelligence guy, at least for an extended period of time. But I think the reason he was killed off is because he could have... he had a platform and probably would have trounced the official narrative about what those bombings were. It was like an American retaliation for the USS Cole or something like that. And they wanted to say, I think that if I remember correctly, it was something like, oh, this was targeting like Al-Qaeda installations, but it was a refugee camp. So it was probably lots of dead civilians. And I don't think they wanted war correspondents in there.
Okay.
That's tough.
Yeah, that's a tough
something
one.
Like that. But anyway, it's a very spooky crowd. And Maxwell had spent several years prior trying to get one of the Kennedys under her thumb.
Yeah, it's weird. If you're
RFK Jr.
I think if you grow up a Kennedy, you're just a target for all this stuff because you're like American royalty. And like the Maxwells wanted to be like royalty in England. Yes. But then when he came to America, I think he was like, I could be royalty here. I'll just get my daughter to marry.
He basically said that.
JFK Jr.
Yeah, he was super weird with his daughter. I was listening to something, and, like, I don't have a kid, so, like, I don't know how I would answer a phone call if my daughter called me, but he's sitting there meowing at his daughter, like, 10 times over. The shit seems kind of weird.
It's called an electric complex.
it's super weird. Also, on the Lady Ghislaine, which he named after Ghislaine, she had portraits of herself commissioned for her father for use on the yacht, and some of them were, like, racy, dude.
Weird.
I mean, very weird, but that is bizarre.
People blur the lines, dude. Not
he was abusive. He was definitely a narcissist, and narcissistic parents oftentimes see no boundaries between them and their children. They see their children as extensions of themselves, and so they, like, just do whatever sociopathically to engineer them to, like, service their needs.
So crazy.
And
it is weird.
So, like, Ghislaine Maxwell is definitely a product of that, 100%. I mean, I kind of feel bad for her in that sense. Definitely doesn't absolve her of anything she did.
Yeah.
But definitely was groomed for the behavior she later engaged in by her father in a very, like, traumatic way, 100%.
And weird.
A lot of the other kids were traumatized by him, too, but not to the extent Ghislaine was.
Did you see the Tetris movie?
She was the favorite child.
Did you see the Tetris movie they made?
No, I didn't, but I was, before the movie came out, familiar with his forays into early video gaming, which is part of the whole, like, Maxwell family push into software, which is also drastically underreported.
And I think the son in it is Kevin. Well, I don't know which son it's supposed to be,
but I think
it's
Kevin.
He's such a dick to him in the movie.
Yeah, after watching the House of Maxwell, it seems like, if, like, we're talking video games, Trump's Mario and fucking Maxwell is Wario. Like, he reminded me of Trump the way he held it down. And he was very bizarre, but it was, like, Trumpish.
Big eyebrows, too.
Yeah. Just proportion-wise, like...
Well, you know, Trump hung out on the Maxwell yacht before Robert Maxwell died. Like, there's pictures of them palling around together. John Tower is in that picture, actually.
John Tower dies in a plane crash.
John Tower Maxwell.
And allegedly...
Well, it was a suspicious plane crash.
Yeah, and allegedly, like, Maxwell was nervous. Like, because, I mean, dude, if you're dealing with this stuff and then one of the boys goes down...
Yeah.
Like, you're like, oh, shit, I'm next.
Yep. Uh-huh.
It was.
I mean, I think John Tower was probably murdered. Maxwell was.
Can I ask you a weird question?
Sure.
What do you think about Webb Hubble being Chelsea Clinton's dad?
Yeah, I think it's definitely possible.
Let's go.
The Hillary-Bill Clinton marriage is, like, not real. I think it was always one of those, like, oh, this is to, like, advance the careers of both of us.
Right.
And Hillary was at Rose Law Firm with Hubble and Foster and was definitely spent a lot more time with them than she did Bill Clinton.
Yeah, there's another guy in the book that I was like, I don't know about because I'm dumb, but Jackson Stevens. There's this dude, Jackson Stevens. He's like a big deal with Clinton and all that stuff.
And also Bush Sr.
I've never heard of this dude before. I mean, it could be that I'm just retarded.
Yeah, who is he?
No, I think it's intentional that no one really knows about him unless you, like, research this stuff. It's because he was, like, this big oligarch with a base in Arkansas. And there's a lot of big corporations based in Arkansas, like the Walmart.
Dude, you know,
Walmart
dude,
family
Hillary
Waltons,
Clinton.
They're tied up with the Clintons, too.
Dude, Hillary Clinton was on the board of Walmart.
For real?
And TCBY yogurt.
It's because of the same Arkansas thing.
Now, am I remembering this right? It wasn't her first, like, case as a lawyer against some dude who, like, raped a chick? Or, like, an underage girl?
It's possible. Remember. I feel like I may have heard that before, but I can't recall exactly. But as far as the book goes, I didn't go into, like, Hillary's early history, but I did talk about, you know, once Clinton was governor, she was still working at Rose Law Firm, which was the law firm that Jackson Stevens, web of companies used. And a lot of those companies were involved in intelligence-linked activities, including some to Iran-Contra. There was a lot of very shady financial activity that took place, and Clinton... when he was governor, sort of relaunched or, like, reorganized various aspects of the state for financial purposes so that Jackson Stevens could launder money more effectively or grift off of taxpayer money, all sorts of stuff.
Yeah, like,
a lot of really crazy stuff happened
there. Rose Law is, at one point, I think it was Webb Hubble, Vince Foster, and Hillary Clinton. So then Vince Foster gets killed. And it's like a whole fucking shit show.
Yeah.
There's also Mark Middleton, the guy that was involved with Mark Middleton a lot that ran it. I think his name was C. Joseph G-I-R-O-I-R, Girard, I don't know. I can't pronounce French shit at all, but it's something like that.
Yeah, but and Vince Foster got killed, and, like, what is it? What, like, I never knew that they went back that far and that they're chilling with Webb Hubble and all this stuff.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, I mean, it's a nexus that goes back, like, quite a long time, and they were involved in a lot of very illegal stuff, and Vince Foster got, like, spooked about some of it. Before he died, and, you know, it's kind of up in the air exactly why. I mean, there were different people that investigated it and had, like, sources that made all these claims. A lot of it involved Israeli intelligence. A lot of it centered around stuff like Promise and, like, NSA secrets and stuff like that that Foster and Hillary Clinton were allegedly selling to foreign entities. And Foster was obviously afraid something was going to come out. He got spooked about something.
If we hear about something, like you were saying, that the Khashoggi thing could have been, like, knocking somebody down a peg. Like, do you remember when we heard about, and it was on the news, that, like, there was a weird sex ring with Hillary Clinton's State Department? It was, like, 2013 or 2014. It was, like, it's like a news clip where they're, like, they found, like, a sex ring or some shit going on while Hillary was Secretary of State.
Well, I don't necessarily recall that, but, I mean, it honestly would not surprise me. There's a Maxwell in her State Department, too, running, like, a key desk.
So, I think it went back to, like, DynCorp and then doing kids overseas, something like this. I can't remember.
With Hillary and Bill Clinton, like, was Hillary the more powerful person? They just used Bill? Or, like, do you have a gauge on that?
I think it's hard to say who's more powerful. I mean, I think Hillary was, like, definitely seen as, like, the more competent criminal out of the two.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I mean, Bill Clinton's a lot more, like, was a lot more effective in terms of being, like, a figurehead who could, like, play the role they wanted him to play, being, like, you know, charming and charismatic and whatever. I mean, they were trying to, like, I mean, they do this a lot. They wanted someone that was the polar opposite of Bush Sr. in the Reagan era to make people think that change had come, but really, you know,
the other side's
they're winning. All Iran-Contra dudes. You know what I mean? So, you know, Clinton, like, played the sax and, like, seemed affable and, like, kind of dumb. I mean, sort of like George W. Bush, like, oh, George W. Bush is dumb. Well, he's not really dumb.
Yeah, he's smart. Yeah.
He's good. He's really good at playing dumb. You know what I mean? And the same thing I think they used to with, like, Biden being, like, completely senile.
That's why, yeah.
That gives them, when the figurehead is like that, or at least portrays that, then people think everything that's happening is because of incompetence, not because of deliberate criminality. And I think they use that to their advantage. Whoever makes the policies of the Biden administration is doing that on purpose. Yeah. It's obviously not Joe Biden. Biden being there as the figurehead and being an idiot makes people go, oh, well, it's because there's an idiot in charge. No, that's not why it's happening. It's completely intentional. And this is how the left-right paradigm works. You have one of the hands, either left or right, bungle something up, arguably, I think, on purpose, and then the other hand comes in and offers the solution to the crisis that the other hand has made, and people think they're fixing the problem, but it's the solution they wanted to implement the entire
time. So you're saying there's a problem and a reaction and then a solution.
Yes, correct. And so basically, you know, what happened, like, so let's take the current border fiasco, for example. That is 100% deliberate, and it's been going on for a long time. Yeah, I mean, this is a policy that is not exclusive to the Biden administration. Trump was supposed to build the wall and didn't build the wall. And, you know, the kids in cages thing was actually an Obama era thing that Trump continued. I mean, there's been a lot of continuity in that stuff.
All those migrant caravans we just looked into a little while ago, it's like, oh, yeah, they were hiking 48 miles a day.
That's impossible.
Shit. And, like, they were doing actual photo ops on the border, and everyone's, this is outrageous. Like, my mom right now can't talk about anything but what's going on down the border, and it's like fucking her head up, and I'm trying to explain to her that it's like, it's just to get you pissed off.
It hurts when you see the parents go down.
Yeah, because here's what they're trying to do right now. All the stuff that Trump's base is worried and angry about, or were, stuff like digital IDs, CBDCs, they are now manufacturing the reasons that will be used to sell that same stuff to the people that hate it right now.
Yeah.
So instead of, like, selling it under left-leaning talking points, they're going to sell it under right-leaning talking points. So the migrant situation in the U.S., they're going to say, oh, well, now we're going to do, I don't know, stuff Republicans have been pushing for a long time, mandatory voter ID or mandatory ID for this and that. And it'll be federal ID, and it will be digital ID.
Yeah, we have to get this thing called real ID, and we don't have a choice to get out of it. Like, you just have to get this new ID or you can't drive.
Yeah.
I can see how they did, like, they literally did that with elections where they just, like, let people vote without an ID to get, like, right-wing people so pissed off. They're like, we need a state ID.
Yeah,
so
that the right-wing people will be like, yes, this is a solution, please do it.
So our president can get in.
Yeah, but which party is traditionally the tough on crime, tough on terror party? It's the Republicans. So they're going to come in and be like, oh, we're going to crack down on the crime and crack down on the terror, and here's
the
digital
ID. That's enough for
that
today.
The Biden administration's been helping to develop. Even people that have been against, like CBDCs, for example, Ron DeSantis, Florida is very far along in their digital ID pilot right now.
That's tough.
Like, these guys are all pushing it. They're just trying to see how they can get people in the U.S. to go along with it. And if you're trying to get people in the U.S. to go along with something, you want the people with the guns to be as complacent as possible.
Exactly.
And the way you get the people with the guns to be as complacent as possible is to make them think they've won. So Trump is definitely going to win this election.
Yeah,
I'm sure he'll do a bunch of stuff like voter fraud's coming. Oh, they're trying to do mail-in ballots. They're going to get, like, the Trump's base, the right-leaning base, like, very worked up. It's already starting. They want to get them as worked up as possible, and then they'll make it, however Trump comes into power, look like a hard-fought victory, and, oh, look, Trump beat the deep state and is in office, despite their best efforts.
It'll be very cinematic. Be like,
I'm going to sit back and relax and let Trump take care of everything. I'm going to trust the plan. And
she's hurting me now.
Going hard after the criminals, going hard after the terrorists, and these people forget that the target of the war on domestic terror, the infrastructure that's been set up by the Trump administration and the Biden administration, is about going after Trump's base.
Oof.
So they're going to be like, yeah, Trump, we want to give you all these powers to go after the deep state, and it turns out, oh, shit.
It's to round us up.
That shit at us.
Yeah, that is fucking tough, dude.
I think that's what's happening.
It hurts.
And it's very unsettling to me, because, I mean, these guys love to, like, invert stuff, and there's nothing they love to do more to, like,
symbols.
The people they want to destroy than have those people cheer on their own destruction. Like,
yeah,
they love that shit.
Very satanic how they operate.
Totally, and that's, you know, there's nothing they love more than that shit.
Yeah.
They want people to voluntarily cheer on their own destruction. They love getting people to do that. And it also, for them, is like a way of showing, like, mastery over, you know, how they can manipulate people's minds, I think, too. So, like, during the COVID era, you had all these, like, progressive people that forever, you know, were, like, tolerance and all this stuff, right? And, like, whatever. And then in the COVID era, they're, like, all authoritarian Nazis and want to use the power of the state to, like, trample on people that don't agree with them. And the right thinks they're not susceptible to that, including people that define as, like, libertarian or ANCAPs or whatever. And they're, like, cheering that on. I mean, they're very poised to cheer that on if they think their guy's in power. Like, if you look at Javier Milei in Argentina, who
ran. Can you please explain this guy to us?
Capitalist.
Everyone gives a shit because I'm just like, dude,
he
I don't
cried
trust
at
this
the
guy.
Wall, dude.
He was bawling at the wall. That shit was the weirdest video I've ever seen.
He's like Mossad handler. Yeah, I know.
The Chabad.
Who is
he? He went to the Rebbe's grave and all that stuff, and is very tied up with, like, the Chabad Lubavitch network in Argentina, which is centered around this guy named Eduardo Elstein, that in Argentina is referred to as the owner, el dueño.
Yeah, the landlord.
He owns everything. He's one of the oligarchs behind Mauricio Macri, who was the administration before the one that Milei replaced. And basically, the vast majority of people in Milei's cabinet are from the Macri administration. So Milei ran on a campaign of being against the political establishment and people that were in the previous government. That caused an economic crisis by being insanely corrupt. That's who is back in power with Milei.
And
one of his security minister was Macri's security minister and was very controversial under Macri. And now she's pushing for, like, extreme powers to criminalize any protest, regardless of who it comes from. And so people are cheering it on as, oh, yeah, Argentinian communists are getting what they deserve.
Yeah.
But that stuff is always used against anyone. What if Milei does something you don't like and you want to protest it? Well, now you can't either. You know, what if he betrays all the,
he owned Klaus Schwab.
Yeah, that was the weirdest. Like, his going to the WEF and people are like, see, he tells it like it is. It's like, dude, this is the most theater.
And the landlord guy, the owner, he, I think, has the voting machine. He's in a company that does voting machines.
Yes. Yes.
So, I mean, they're cheering that on. Yes. They're getting trumped, is what I would say. They're getting their own Trump. He's got fucked up hair. He's like, chainsaws.
Yeah, totally. It's one of these, like, campaign, anti-establishment campaign rhetoric, but when they're in power, they serve the establishment. So, you know, Trump was very cozy with Wall Street, for example, which, like, is a key part of the deep state in the U.S. Very important. And Malay has put almost the entire government under the care of former J.P. Morgan and Deutsche Bank's executives, and those are the Epstein banks, you know?
Yeah, maybe we'll get a Malay Heights in Israel.
Yeah, right.
When it surprised me, honestly. But, like, I'm really worried about what Malay is going to do in Argentina. He just had a meeting with Larry Fink, where basically Larry Fink, by the way, a lot of Argentinian debt is held by BlackRock and Larry Fink. And so Larry Fink is coming in being like, how can we buy more of your infrastructure since you're about to privatize it all?
Yeah, right.
And Argentinians, as someone that lives on the, like, near Argentina and knows a lot of people from there and has been there to do on the ground reporting in the past, there's nothing people in Argentina hate more than the IMF. And so they assumed that Milei was going to try and stick it to the IMF when he was campaigning. And ever since he's been elected, he's been super cozy with the IMF. The IMF praises everything he does. It's very weird. And if you think, but it's not really weird, I guess, in the sense of what does the IMF do? They use debt slavery to force governments to, like, deregulate their markets so that these predatory foreign multinational companies or asset managers like BlackRock can come and buy up everything and basically, like, take indirect ownership of the country. And Malay is doing that without having to use the IMF. He's like, you know, the IMF was trying to use debt slavery to get that to happen, and Malay's like, I'll just do it, you know? And it's these J.P. Morgan, Deutsche Bank guys. And then another one of his top advisors used to be BlackRock's man on the ground in Argentina and helped them get a major stake in the power monopoly of Argentina. So these are not anti-establishment people that Malay has put in. These are people that serve the international banking cartel. And that's seems like who Malay is content to have run large swaths of stuff. I mean, his economy minister, who was this ex J.P. Morgan, Deutsche Bank guy. And there's another guy that worked with him at J.P. Morgan and Deutsche Bank in charge of the Central Bank of Argentina. He was like, said he was going to close down and didn't or whatever. But that guy, he didn't just make economy minister. He's minister of mining. He's minister of agriculture. He's minister of tons of things. He's referred to now as a super minister. And people thought the whole thing with the chainsaw was like, I'm going to cut down the government and get rid of all these ministries. Well, he didn't really get rid of them. He placed them all under this one guy, you know? Organized. So you have less ministers, but you have the same stuff is still there. It's just all under this one J.P. Morgan guy now.
They're getting hurt right now. Argentina's getting hurt.
I can't remember. Remember that, like, viral picture of the old white dude shooting the gun, shot the protester?
What are you talking about?
It just happened.
In Chile?
Is that in Chile? Yeah.
Yeah.
Didn't that have something? That had nothing to do with, like, environmentalists. It didn't have to do something with, like, there's, like, brutal mining.
No, you're talking about the Panama guy?
No, it's Chile.
Oh, I thought that was fuck Panama.
I think.
In 2019, there were some big protests in Chile that were affiliated with, like, the progressive left and the power, well, like, the political movement that brought the current Chilean president to power. And in 2019, there was an American guy living in Chile that shot at protesters and went to prison. Is that what you're referring to?
No, he's talking about about the dude that was, like, recently, like, killed
was
a guy.
Like a still of, like, the bullet casing in the air. It was like a white dude. I think it's Panama where it's like mining stuff. Disregard. Doesn't matter. But,
well, mining stuff in Latin America is insanely brutal, and I have personal anecdotes about that.
Yeah, like, doesn't Chile have a ton of copper?
For a long time. Yeah, it has. It's like the biggest exporter of copper globally. I think number two is Peru, which is above Chile. And then Chile has a lot of lithium as well. The lithium triangle is shared by Bolivia, Argentina.
That's another thing with Musk. Yeah, they all love Musk, but he'll body a country for lithium.
Yeah, he's in talks with Chile for lithium right now.
What experiences, like, what happens with you in mining in Chile?
Well, I don't know so much about it in Chile because it all happens in the north and I live way south. But I used to live in Peru for a couple years and I lived in the main mining region. And that shit was nuts because basically I managed like a farm for a Cuban American lady in the middle of nowhere. And there were, you know, mines all over the place and like the Andean highlands. And it's like very poor. Most of the people don't even speak Spanish. They speak Quechua. There's like a really high illiteracy rate.
Is this where the guanchos
are? They're very vulnerable people and they come in there and mine. And locals will protest and be like, we don't want your mine here. And then the Peruvian government or the multi on behalf of the multinational mining company, because they're not Peruvian mining companies, they're like American or Australian or Canadian or whatever. They'll bring in the Peruvian military and they'll decide who the ringleader is of the resistance to the mine. And they'll put garbage bags over their head and march them off cliffs.
Oh, my God.
And it's just like that's just what happens because like no one finds the body because it's like.
Yeah, it's Peru.
Super mountainous. Yeah. And those people, most of them can't even write. They speak Quechua, which, like, most, I mean, most people in Latin America don't speak that.
Oh, this is, like, probably indigenous stuff, dude.
Does it even sound remotely like anything, or is it, like, a whole different...
It's a whole different thing. It's like it doesn't share anything with the Romance languages, which are, like, the Latin-based languages. English is kind of one of those.
Okay.
Kind of not, but Spanish is, French is, right? Yeah, it doesn't share anything with any of those. Totally different language family.
Have you ever been to Easter Island?
No, I haven't. It's part of Chile, though. I've wanted to go.
I want
to
go.
It's kind of hard with kids because I live south of Santiago. You have to fly to the capital and then from the capital take a 5-hour flight through the Pacific to get to Easter Island. Someday I'd like to go.
What about Patagonia?
Yeah, I mean, basically live in Patagonia. Where it like starts.
Jealous.
So cool.
It's very cool. It's also, you know, a very chill place. Land is pretty cheap. Lots of clean water.
Yeah, we live in Philadelphia.
Yeah. Maybe I'll come visit you.
So it's brutal down here.
Yeah, well, it's a lot harder to homestead in Philadelphia than down here, that's for sure.
The weird thing about Maya, I don't know if you'd like looked into this at all, but what's the deal with Hillary Clinton's like brother? Didn't he own a gold mine in Haiti?
I don't know, actually, because, you know, whatever I looked into about the Clintons in Haiti was, like, several years ago.
Right.
There is the weird stuff with, like, trafficking and Laura Silsby. There's the weird stuff with the Clinton Global Initiative and Clinton Foundation after, like, the earthquake in Haiti. But I,
there's definitely a lot of the body details of
that I don't remember, but I'm sure there's stuff like that. I mean, the Clinton family in particular have been point men for the modern pillaging of Haiti. I would argue that Haiti has been, a huge target for a long time for like repression through really every mean possible because they were the first like meaningful slave revolt in the Americas, which like freaked out their, you know, European colonial, you know, forces, not just the people they, you know, the French that they kicked out, like everybody got spooked by Haiti when that happened. And they're like, how do we keep these people from doing that again?
You can't believe they just did that.
Yeah, I don't think they were happy about that. Because it set examples for a lot of other stuff. It inspired slave revolts elsewhere, you know. And now they have lots of different tactics to keep slaves from even knowing they're slaves.
Yeah.
But still keeping them slaves. I mean, debt is a big
one. Gotta pay my taxes. It's like, is there anything that's like we have like the Promise software like really freaks us out. Is there something that like really fucking actually freaks you out? Or are you kind of like jaded to all this stuff just from looking into it?
I mean, I'm really jaded and I also live far away from the U.S. So I tend not to get like too like freaked out because of the physical distance in a sense. I do get really worried about the war on domestic terror because I feel like people just do not understand why that's being set up and who it's going to target and how it's going to work. And people somehow think that Trump wouldn't do that to his own base.
Yeah.
You know, but I don't know, guys. You guys, I mean... People need to look into that stuff.
What about Poly Cybergon? Do you think they're going to do it?
Like, oh, Cyber Polygon?
Cyber Polygon, yeah. Sorry, my bad.
Okay. Well, Cyber Polygon was this thing that the WEF did, these simulations about cyber attacks that were done in conjunction with Russia's largest bank, Sberbank, and a lot of the biggest banks in the world, frankly. And, you know, it was sort of this framing during the COVID era that after COVID, there was going to be this cyber pandemic, they called it. And I think, you know, if they do go that route, what that means is that there's going to be sort of cascading cyber events of various severity. I do think the WEF has been quite open in signaling that they expect some sort of large cyber event to take place this year. So when at their annual meeting in January 2023, one of their top guys, who was one of the leaders of Cyber Polygon, said that they anticipated a major cyber event globally before January 2025. So
yeah, okay.
That would be this year. And there's some other a lot of foreshadowing of some sort of big cyber event, including from FBI Director Christopher Wray, sort of saying, I mean, they're blaming like China and Iran and all of this, but I mean, who knows, honestly, like I said earlier with Vault 7, it could be an own goal and they can claim it as China or Iran or whatever. And a lot of the companies that are attributing blame and reporting about these cyber events, whether it's cyber attacks or cyber intrusions where they claim someone is in the system but doesn't do anything, those are all companies founded by NQTEL, the CIA.
Oh, yeah, right.
Or they're funded by, or they're created by, you know, Israel's Signal Intelligence Agency, Unit 8200. That's not good. We should not be believing intelligence front companies about who's to blame for stuff because they have an extreme track record of lying, right? And lying us into war. So, you know, it's very complicated. But on one thing I think that, you know, aside from the fact that it's likely and these groups are saying it's likely, what I think people fail to understand is that almost all of these simulations or tabletop exercises or bigwig meetings about this kind of stuff overwhelmingly involve the biggest banks in the world. It's very likely because of that, I think, that the one of these, if not the cyber event, the cyber 9/11, as it were, is likely to involve the financial system, because that creates a very cozy justification to cover up the explosion of the economic bubble we're in. Yeah. The collapse of banks that started really with Silicon Valley Bank and was sort of the hole was sort of plugged, but they can't really stop it from falling apart. And so some banks here and there have been failing. Lots of bank branches, regional bank branches, have closed this year. Bank earnings pretty much across the board are down. There's a lot of issues. So how do you cover all of that up and aren't left holding the bag like you were in 2008 and spawning Occupy Wall Street and angry people being like, where's my money? Why'd you steal all this money? You blame faceless hackers for that.
So you think like
a control alt delete.
Yeah. Jesus. And one of the guys that was in charge of one of these simulations involving all the banks, including the Fed, like the central bank, and also like JP Morgan and stuff, was William Burns, who is now CIA director.
Fuck.
There is some weird shit about to go down. And when everything, if that happens and they're like, oh, hackers have frozen the financial system, it's the perfect opportunity to onboard people to whatever the digital dollar will be, the CBDC or CBDC equivalent.
So like
they'll be like, your money's gone, but you can claim these, which is, you know, you had $10,000 in this account and now it's gone. Well, you can have 10,000 digital dollars.
So
just sign up for this and you'll get your money back. You know what I mean?
So like the deep state will run, they'll like be running and gunning, and then after a while they're like, man, we're really making a mess, and then we gotta clean up, but we gotta like tell the plebs like what's going on. So then they have like a big theatrical thing where they can do a cleanup. And then they use the media to be like, check this out. Like,
well, so financially, economically, the fundamentals of all of that right now, there's no way it doesn't collapse. It's an inevitability. You know, you're dealing with a debt-based monetary system. They've kicked the can down the road, I think, as much as they can through things like quantitative easing and things like that, you know?
And the game's almost over.
Economic, yeah. They can't keep doing this forever. Also, U.S. government debt is the highest it's ever been. It's reached completely insane levels. It's like past 34 trillion.
Yeah, it's 34 trillion, yeah.
Yeah, so eventually, because it's debt, right, whatever income the U.S. government has, at a certain point, all of that will go to servicing the debt and won't be paying for essential government services. Social Security will collapse. It'll lead to unrest. So how do you collapse the bubble in such a way that you're not blamed for it?
Hackers.
You know? And I think they're looking at a cyber attack because of the huge involvement of all of these banks and the central bank in these simulations about big cyber attacks with, intelligence linked entities and also the World Economic Forum.
So it would be like a great reset.
Well, yes, but, I think the Great Reset has become one of those buzzwords, like the deep state, that people don't fundamentally, like, understand what they're talking about anymore, because it's just become, like, this catch-all word for, like, everything bad, in people's heads. But basically, it's this, they want to create a new financial system. And the central bankers have been open about this for some time. Like Mark Carney, who is former Goldman Sachs and then was head of England and then Canada's central bank and is now the top UN envoy for climate finance. Before COVID, he was talking about, we have to create a new financial system at this meeting of all these central bankers. We have to create a new inclusive multipolar financial system and all these things. And then he teamed up with Larry Fink and Mike Bloomberg. And their whole thing is, we have to create a new system, global system of financial governance. They want to have like a Bretton Woods 2.0.
Right.
And the Bretton Woods thing is like, dollars, the reserve currency, creates the IMF, it creates the World Bank. They want to recreate that system, and they're openly doing it. Larry Fink has talked about reimagining the World Bank and the IMF or did several years ago, and that has happened. Yeah. And one of the ways they want to do this is by creating global carbon markets. And so for a long time, they were framing this to the left as like necessary for climate change.
Yeah.
We literally have to create this new financial system to save the planet, but that didn't work. So now they're moving to other stuff. All their justifications. And it seems like if you look at how Larry Fink has pivoted now, because he's abandoned ESG. He's like, ESG's become too politicized. I'm not doing that anymore. And it was never about the environment anyway. It was about profit. And he's pivoting into this whole thing of like, if you buy into the system, you'll get super rich and stuff like that. Like it seems again, like this shift of like trying to appeal to people on the right, as opposed to using these like faux collectivist talking points, And I think again, like talking about Javier Milei, like why he was at the WEF, the theme of the WEF in recent years, including this year, is rebuilding trust. So they want the people that don't trust them right now to trust them. How do you do that? Well, what is the WEF really? I think people don't understand that either. The WEF was created to advance public-private partnerships around the world.
I had no idea.
That's its stated existing purpose. And broadly, this form of where everything is a public-private partnership is part of the stakeholder capitalism model that Klaus Schwab created. People look at Klaus Schwab as a boogeyman and, frame him as, like, communist and all of this stuff, but they don't actually, like, look at what's actually going on here, because the public-private thing, you either have the impression that the public sector is leading it, is the dominant force in the public-private sector, or that the private is dominant. And so the way the WEF has framed its stuff up until now has been, this is the public sector leading, but it's a public-private partnership. And now with Milei, in my opinion, they're swinging it to the other side. Oh, we're going to let the private lead, let the free market lead. But it's not really the free market. These are all crony capitalists, So, I mean, these are like the oligarchs and billionaires of the world that meet at Davos.
In their commercial, they're going to...
No, it's all good. So I honestly think that they're doing this swing in rhetoric as a way to try and rebuild trust. And they're going to use people like Milei and Bolsonaro and Trump that sort of have that anti-establishment appeal, but are, very much willing to, serve the interests of the banking cartels in the world.
Yeah, and their video for the highlights.
Towards this new financial system.
Yeah, the highlights of this year, they're talking about how there's over 70 elections in the world. But, like, AI is gonna... Somehow AI is involved in this. I don't understand this part of their commercial at all. They're like, the voters could vote for who they are, or AI could get involved, and we don't really know what to do about that.
Yeah, that stuff... AI stuff's a little too weird for me now, especially since Musk is all about it.
Well, I think they've been overhyping a lot of it. I think there's a lot of different things we could talk about with AI.
I think
the whole idea of the singularity, like artificial general intelligence, is a psyop. I think they're going to fake that and convince people that they're super intelligent AI, that we should give power over everything, including the government, over to AI because it's objective and it's superior in intelligence to humans and all this stuff. I think they're going to try and psyop us into believing that. I think there's a lot of grift in the AI industry in terms of like accuracy of algorithms. companies will say, like, oh, yeah, our algorithm is X percent accurate. But usually that those statistics aren't audited by an independent person. That's like marketing material. So it's probably way lower. And they want to put it in charge of all sorts of stuff, including stuff like in Israel right now, you know, in the Gaza conflict, they're using AI to choose who lives and who dies.
Dude.
It's like RoboCop, dude.
That's what I was going to say. It's perfect for like bombing a wedding in the Middle East and no one feeling bad about it.
Well, I think the war on terror was meant to desensitize Americans to that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
You know, and just be like, oh, well, this is normal and this is what we do and what can we do about it?
They're using it at the border, too. What was that company we were looking at that had, it's like... Like, they're, like, young Palantir guys.
Oh, yeah.
Anderle?
Yeah.
Yes.
Palmer Luckey.
The guy with the, Palmer Luckey with the Hawaiian shirts. Yeah.
Another genius in his garage.
The Hawaiian shirt.
He's a psyop.
Surveillance dude. Yeah. Well, he's a Peter Thiel guy.
Yeah,
and
right.
He was a Thiel fellow, and then he created Oculus Rift, which was sold to Facebook when Peter Thiel was a board member of Facebook. And then Peter Thiel funds his Anderle in adventurism, which has built this insane surveillance apparatus on the U.S.-Mexico border that, oddly enough, isn't working right now.
Yeah.
And they're building one on the U.S.-Canada border as well, and I think that's about keeping people in, the surveillance one.
Oh, really? Okay. Whoa. That's creepy. Mm-hmm.
Well, it goes both ways, you know?
Yeah. Guess you're
and people,
right.
What people don't think about the border thing, too, and why I think it's so dangerous that people are so easily flustered about it and are being told it's an invasion. Being told it's an invasion is prepping people to demand a military-style response. Yes?
Jade Helms.
And the situation that a lot of Americans don't realize is that on the books in the U.S., there's this idea of constitutional free zones that I think extend 100 miles
from
the border.
Bill was just telling me about this, yeah.
You're talking about the fusion centers and shit that go along
with
it?
Well, that's part of it, too. That's DHS. And this is part of this broader war on domestic
terror. Is that real?
Structure that's been set up. Yeah, it's real. It's absolutely real.
So you have zero
constitution centers on the DHS website, and it will tell you some stuff about them.
I'm talking about the constitution free zones. Like, that's a real thing.
Oh, totally.
What the
fuck? I'm telling you, DHS and FEMA are terrifying.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not good. So basically, if people are being riled up and told it's an invasion and calling for a military style response, that's not just going to stay in the border. That's going to extend in this whole zone that the U.S. government has legally defined as being border areas, which extend 100 miles in, and 70% of the U.S. population lives in those areas.
We do, yeah.
Because it includes coastal areas also. So like California, Florida, you know, all of Florida is one.
New York.
Because it's a peninsula.
Yeah,
you know?
Right.
So whatever military style provisions or like suspension of rights that are called for about the border will be implemented in those zones as well.
We have to get inland.
Yeah, fucking I gotta get to the Midwest.
Yeah.
It seems like through like all the stuff they're doing, like with AI and all the CBDC stuff, that like it's going to be just like China is with like, you have a picture getting taken of your face if you say bad shit on WeChat.
But I mean, dude, that's like, we get told what China, we've never been to China.
Yeah, true.
You know what I mean? Like, that's how they paint it to us. Who knows what Chinese people think in their world, you know?
True.
Well, China was the testbed for a lot of this stuff. The opening up of China, right, with U.S. capital, a lot of that involved the Rockefellers. It involved Henry Kissinger. It involved a lot of these guys that have sort of been key figures in this creation of, I guess, modern globalization. You know, Henry Kissinger, for example, was like a mentor to Klaus Schwab, for example.
Did you hear this
thing? Is all sort of like the same crowd.
Did you hear this thing, Klaus Schwab saying glocalization?
Oh, no, I missed that. But
this is the new word they're using, because they don't like the globalization. They call it glocalization. Which is
trying to change all their words because they've gotten pushback. And so that's part of what this larger psyop is, to sort of make people think they've won. And now it's moving to the other side, but they're going to push for the same solutions, the same system.
Right.
With different justifications at the end of the day. Kind of forgot where else I was going with this stuff just now.
Yeah, you're talking about Schwab, but
I've fucked it up. I remember what I was going to say. Yeah, this whole crowd that involved the opening up of China was also involved in creating a lot of links between Western corporations and, like, communist Russia, state-owned enterprises. One of the point guys for this is a guy named Samuel Pisar that was Robert Maxwell's best friend, lawyer, and confidant. And he's the guy that raised Anthony Blinken, who's the current Secretary of State of the U.S., his stepfather.
And he's boys with Armie Hammer's family.
Armie Hammer, yeah. Who's part of the same network I'm talking
about. Does that ever get you, like, weirded out how their kids end up kind of being celebrities? Like, I'm not saying, like, they couldn't be in the entertainment industry, but it's like the Nick Kroll kid got a show. Like, Julia Louis-Dreyfus is from the family.
Like, Lou Wasserman dominating entertainment, you know? Lou Wasserman's crowd is also tied up with all these other guys. I mean, it's the same mafia at the end of the day.
Okay, sorry.
Loosely connected mob, I think. Makes sense.
What are the Maxwell sisters up to right now? Like, are they still in surveillance?
Right now, I don't think they're as active as they used to be, but they were very involved in the early internet and early Silicon Valley stuff, hugely. Created the first search engine, stuff like that.
I remember Magellan.
Very weird ties with Bill Gates and Microsoft, very weird. God, one of the weirdest articles I read in all of Epstein research, besides the one where Leslie Wexner says he's, like, possessed by a demon.
No, it's a DeBook.
The DeBook was killing me, dude.
For all intents and purposes, it's, like, really the same freaking thing. But the other weirdest one was Isabel Maxwell talking about Bill Gates in, like, the year 2000, and she's being interviewed by The Guardian, and The Guardian journalist is like, upon talking about Bill Gates, she starts purring and says in a faux, really makes you wonder, on some weird accent, like a fake Southern Belle accent, starts, like, talking about, like, how she gets, like, money from him so he doesn't have to, like, pay as many taxes or something.
Bill probably gets so, like, horny, dude.
What are you doing? Like, why are you purring and, like, speaking in weird accents when Bill Gates' name is brought up?
Dude, they did it with Daddy. When he called, they started meowing and shit.
Yeah, I don't know. They're a weird bunch. Let's just put it that way. By the way, Isabel Maxwell created Terramar before Ghislaine Maxwell did. It was called the Global Solver Foundation, and Blue World Alliance was its second name.
They keep trying stuff.
It was also tied up with the Clinton Foundation.
It's like try stuff, and then it doesn't work. Like, what do you call it? Bill Gates tried Starlink.
Halidesic was what he tried, and now it's Starlink.
Now it's Starlink. Yeah. So they just keep trying the same shit.
They just gotta get a cooler dude to do it.
Elon's as cool as it gets, bro.
You must have been freaking out when COVID happened and they're like, Bill Gates is the head of it. Like, did that shit, like, really faze you?
She has kids, man.
Like, were you, like, freaking the fuck out? Because, like, you know this shit. Like, I always knew he was, like, a weird nerd dude, but, like, until COVID, I was like, I guess Bill Gates is on a weird one.
Well, I think Bill Gates is honestly, like, kind of a front man. I think a lot of these Silicon Valley billionaires they were made by somebody.
Yes.
You know? Almost all of the big tech companies now were made either with CIA funding or CIA involvement, and almost all of them were underwritten by the same bank, the head of which was this guy named Alvin Krongard, who was on the CIA payroll at the time. He was underwriting all of the future big tech companies.
Yeah, like, if people knew...
Amazon, Microsoft, Google, every single one of them underwrote all of them. And he's also the guy that gets tied up with 9/11 insider trading and then becomes CIA deputy director and all sorts of, like, weird shit. And then starts being working for Leon Black at Apollo Global Management. He's the connection between the CIA and Eric Prince and Blackwater.
Leon Black's, you know, the black dude from Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Really?
The name, yeah.
But, like, you know, Silicon Valley is, I would argue, the big Silicon Valley companies are intelligence fronts and have been for a long time.
Yeah, if people...
Epstein and Maxwell had ties to every single one of the big Silicon Valley billionaires.
If people knew,
those guys have their billions because they were made to have those billions, and they're beholden to them. And Elon Musk is absolutely no exception. Actually, it's arguably more obvious with Elon Musk because so many of his companies, like, relied on subsidies.
Yeah,
right.
From the state.
Like, with Palantir, like, everybody for a while, like, you know, like, Peter Thiel was, like, they were trying to make him cool. But, like, if they knew, like, Richard Perle and the Poindexter dude got him set up with InQtel, people would be like, whoa, 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 Palantir, I don't like the sound of that. You know what I mean?
And also, the guy at the CIA that was, like, the point man for Palantir after they got InQtel money, Alan Wade, was a business partner of Christine Maxwell, Ghislaine's sister Wacky was at the CIA. And they made this company called Kiliad that was like a software program that was really similar to Palantir.
I thought it was called Chiliad. Phased out
as Palantir got big.
Jesus fucking Christ.
And she was involved with the sale of a backdoored promise for her dad in the 80s, including to Los Alamos and stuff.
Yeah, she's a little shyer than Ghislaine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ghislaine's just seems really like a weird interesting one.
And they don't get talked about very much.
What'd you say?
Ghislaine just like, she's like a bizarre character because, like, it is weird. You said it earlier, like, you kind of feel bad for her, and there's just something about her where it's like, fuck, dude, I feel like real bad for you because you are like, you're fucked up in the head.
Well, it's weird because for her, because she was one of the girls, but then there was other ones that were, I don't know about, like, equally as bad or whatever. But they don't really get talked about a lot. Like, one of them ended up marrying the dude that owns Guinness, which broke my heart, and you know that.
Yeah, you love Guinness.
And one of them married a NASCAR driver. Like, these chicks are out here. They're out living their lives, and it's like, they're
a lot of them got immunity from the sweetheart deal.
Yeah, they're portrayed as, like,
almost
victims.
Almost all of them did, and they don't get talked about,
But there's pictures of, you know, there's pictures of them and Jeffrey. Like, this one chick, Sarah Kellen, there's pictures of them together where you're like, that doesn't look like a victim. That looks like bae.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's fucking weird. What do you think about the Epstein stuff that just got, like, that seems so, like, weird and, like, limited hangout. That court case that just happened where, like, everyone's, like, digging through it and trying to find shit.
The new list or whatever.
Oh, the docs or whatever?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wasn't that just, I mean, so, like, anyone could be in a court case.
Yeah, I think it was largely distractionary because so people were talking about the unredaction of the names. Of the names that were redacted, 100 of them were already known before this new release. So it was like 67 new names, and a lot of it is like testimony that wasn't necessarily corroborated, or like a lot of the names that were unredacted, that hadn't been unredacted before or hadn't been known before, weren't necessarily named in the context of doing anything bad.
Yeah, it makes sense.
So it was kind of like given all this hype, but you know what didn't get a lot of hype? The J.P. Morgan U.S. Virgin Island case.
Oh, that was crazy. Settled.
J.P. Morgan paid millions of dollars to a law firm to avoid having to take that to court. And just in discovery alone, a lot of stuff was starting to come out that was not good. I think the most recent reporting on that revealed that Epstein was basically gathering suggestions for Treasury Secretary to give to Trump.
What was the lady? There was a there's a woman who was the president of one of the islands, and she was like
Cecil DeJong. Yeah.
Epstein was gonna get her kids to college or something. Yes. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, Epstein's activities in the U.S. Virgin Islands are very disturbing. They centered around this company called Southern Trust and its subsidiaries, like Financial Trust. They were headquartered at this very suspect marina that's owned by this guy named Andrew Farkas, who is very tied up with Andrew Cuomo's political career. And a big marina guy, big banker guy. No one's ever gone after him, actually, but he was just as close to Epstein as Jess Staley was. And there were other entities at this marina that were setting up, like, private comm towers between St. Thomas and Little St. James, which is Epstein's island, and, like, private internet cables going to the island, and, like, all this weird infrastructure was being set up for something at the island. And then you think about, like, Epstein gets caught in 2019. They take like a month to go to the island and raid it. Before Epstein was arrested, he ordered all these cement mixers to the island. Yes. Like, why'd he do that?
There's guys
no one interested in that. Why is it that all these people were subpoenaed as part of the JP Morgan Epstein case and that gets no coverage? Elon Musk was one of them. The Google co-founders were two that were subpoenaed, and like literally Larry Page of Google disappeared in order to not be subpoenaed.
Yeah.
He just disappeared. And he owns how many islands? He owns a bunch of islands down there. Richard Branson owns islands down there. Like,
do
all the
Bidens
guys
for real own islands down there too?
Maybe.
Or is that just a meme? The Bidens own an island down near there?
I don't know if that's true or not.
Yeah,
I think there's a lot of efforts to link Biden to Epstein that aren't, like,
yeah.
I haven't seen any direct connection there. Obviously, Biden is very creepy.
Yeah, he seems to have his own
and
games.
If you looked at footage of him when he was, like, vice president and, like, swearing in senators' families and stuff, like, he's obviously
weirdo.
Very creepy and disturbing, and you throw in the Ashley Biden diary and all this stuff. Like, obviously a creep. I'm sure they have lots of stuff on him, but that doesn't mean you can fabricate claims because it's likely that, like, Epstein and Biden would have hung out because they're both creeps.
Yeah,
you know?
True.
There's people that must have shit when Epstein got arrested. Like, I wonder if Elon puckered up a little bit, like him and Kimball. Like, Kimball must have been, because Kimball was hanging out at one of his cribs with a girl that he used to know.
It had to have all been on video.
Dude, you got to get a load of Kimball. He wears a cowboy hat and pushes vertical farming. Yeah,
he's a fucking weirdo.
Yeah, well, Kimball Musk was dating one of the women that used to work for Epstein and was housed at, like, the apartments where the traffic girls were, where, like, Ehud Barak would spend the night and stuff. That was run by his brother, Mark Epstein. And Tucker Carlson interviews Mark Epstein and ask him about OSA properties.
Pierce Morgan did, too.
Managing all this real estate shady shit for Epstein, including the property where all the traffic girls were housed. And, like, it was all witnessed. And there were, like, miners from Eastern Europe living in there and stuff. And, like, heads of state, like Ehud Barak, were coming with their security entourages to sleep over there.
Yeah.
And Tucker Carlson's like, I'm not going to ask Mark about that.
Yeah, Pierce Morgan had him on, too, and he would, like, I don't know what he asked him. He asked him some, like, softball questions, but then Pierce Morgan will have, like, Andrew Tate on it, and everybody's like, he's so cool.
Yeah. That is, it's weird that, like, Tucker Carlson, like, left, and then now he's interviewing, like, Epstein's brother, and now he's doing this shit with, like, this is what's really, like, freaking me out. Like, out of nowhere, Tucker Carlson's like, I'm going to Moscow and interviewing fucking Putin. So, like, whatever the hell is going to come out of this two-hour interview with Putin has to be some sort of PSYOP material, because, like, this is so
PSYOP $7 out of me on fucking Assange.
And they're trying to make this whole thing of the deep state is just the Democrats. It's just Klaus Schwab and the WEF or whatever, even though the WEF is, like, clearly trying to reinvent itself, in my opinion. But it's, like, very specific stuff, and, like, the Republican Party is not part of the deep state.
Yeah.
And, like, these other guys are not, like, they're picking and choosing in terms of, like, narrative building, like, who's the deep state and who's not. And I think, you know, it's all about this trust building thing, because they want to push people into the same system, and they're not, the people won't go if the current people who are pushing it continue to push it. They got to have new faces push it under new justifications.
Yeah.
And so they're hurting people that way, in my opinion. And if you look at Putin and China, so, I mean, basically, like, you want to talk about great power competition, there's the West, and then there's the BRICS countries, right? But who dominates BRICS? It's Russia and China, obviously, just in terms of, like, economic terms, really. And geopolitical, military strength, whatever. So those are, like, the main power factions, I guess you could say. And BRICS is a big backer of this whole idea of a multipolar world order, the UN having greater global governance. Russia and China are fully committed to the Sustainable Development Goals, Agenda 2030, as is the WEF, as is the West. Yep. They all agree about that stuff. The question is, how do we get there, or who gets the bigger seats?
Yeah, who wins, yeah.
Yeah, so the argument, in my opinion, these days is really more about the spoils, not about the plan.
So we as like, you know, peasants are, we're going to be like, we're going to be back. It's going to be like the castle, and then we live outside the castle type thing, like back in the old times.
Well, like serfdom.
Yes. Yeah,
this is feudalism making a comeback, totally, but it's going to be enforced with, like, insanely invasive technology.
And it's not that far to think that it could happen, because, like, if they got all the, like, people who are on the left with, like, the COVID vaccine, they can do something that'll trick the right wing people into the same thing.
And people on the right somehow think they're not psyopable.
Oh, yeah.
I'm extremely psyopable. You
know? I got into queue for, like, 5 minutes just because it was interesting. I'm not going to say I didn't go to the Capitol or anything like that, but it was just interesting what
he
was saying.
You didn't go to see, like, the resurrected JFK zombie in the plaza?
No. It was weird because we just watched...
Junior's Alive.
We just watched January 6th footage. And, like, dude, that shit looks so fake.
Oh, yeah.
Like, people are getting, like, eating pepper spray with a gaping wound on his cheek. The dude gets pepper sprayed, doesn't even flinch, continues on. Like, it's really fucking weird that they did that whole January 6th thing and made that big, like...
Yeah, there's this guy, Woo's News. He made, like, a video where he's like, dude, this is so fake. This is, like, a FEMA drill. And I don't know how this guy's cruising around. Like, he made a video where he kind of exposed January 6th was staged... But, like,
there
way,
was a lot of videos,
way more
though, when it happened, right?
Yeah.
Of, like, police officers waving people in and stuff. So, me and my colleague, Ryan Christian, I mean, we basically knew January 6th was coming before it happened.
Whoa.
We did, like, an election special before the 2020 election, and we were showing this clip from this congressional hearing of this DHS lady a little less than a year before January 6th, named Elizabeth Newman, and she was like... anti-Semitic Trump supporters are a threat to our democracy, and if Trump, like, doesn't win, they're going to do another 9/11, and we can see it building, and we can't quite stop it.
And they all had the talking points. Every single politician had the talking points, like, this is the new 9/11.
Right then, and they compared it all to 9/11. What do you know?
Which is fucking crazy, because we built 2 buildings.
And then there was this other group that was, like, had Michael Chertoff, and, like, who was the first head of DHS, and these guys... called the Transition Integrity Project, that was tabletop simulating out Trump losing the election and then something happening with his supporters to try and get him back in power.
An insurrection.
I mean, there was all the stuff, like, before January 6th where they were, like, wanted to have an event like that.
They're putting the feelers out.
And the goal of that was to get more powers for DHS and the FBI to go after people for domestic terrorism, but not under people that have committed domestic terror acts. It's all about stopping domestic terror before it happens. And there was a lot of this rhetoric in the Trump era, but not necessarily about January 6th, but about mass shooters shooting events. And people forget this. Trump was, like, proposing insane shit about that, mm-hmm. about how to stop mass shooters and stuff. And
I don't remember any of this.
From the gun rights guy. You know what I mean? Kushner and Ivanka were pushing for the creation of this health DARPA. That would have this program.
That's terrifying.
The acronym was Safe Homes, but it was basically using AI to crawl everyone's social media posts to look for early warning signs of neuropsychiatric violence.
Hand up. Okay. Hand up right here.
What does that entail?
And
whatever.
Like, what do you think that's about?
Having a rough day. You know what I mean? Yeah, I, like, just in your opinion coming up, because, like, I just want to know, like, what would you use not to get tricked into, like, falling for all this shit that they're about to do with this election?
Drop out, okay. though.
You got to have red lines, and some people are not going to like it, but if you don't want to get caught up in this whole domestic terror dragnet thing, you got to have them. Never connect your internet service provider or your social media account to a government-issued ID. Just do not do it.
Okay.
Didn't do it yet.
All
right.
The NSA and all those guys have all these hacking tools. They probably already know who you are, but they can't legally come after you unless they can have your legal, like, your legal ID tied to you.
My Earth suit saved me.
Because all of the ways they spy on you and know who you are is technically illegal, right?
Yeah.
It's illegal warrantless spying. So then you change it to having your government-issued ID, and then the social media companies all collaborate with these guys. I mean, even Elon Musk is a contractor for intelligence agencies.
Yeah.
You know? They all are interconnected. Silicon Valley is intimately interconnected with the military and intelligence communities just through contracts.
Yeah.
They're all military and intelligence contractors. Okay. So they pass all this information over whenever asked. We learned that from the Snowden stuff. None of that has changed.
Right.
Yeah. And if they can link your ID to it, the government says, we don't like this post. This post is it's a speech crime, because they're moving in that direction. The goal is to frame people who publish misinformation as cyber criminals. The DOJ and the FBI and the Secret Service are all pushing this policy. Yeah. It's part of the WEF Partnership Against Cybercrime, led by a career Israeli spy named Tal Goldstein. It involves the DOJ, FBI, Secret Service, UK and Israeli intelligence, and all of the big banks, and PayPal, and a handful of intelligence agencies like Microsoft, or tech companies like Microsoft and Amazon.
Damn.
They're all pushing for this.
This is hurting.
Do not link that. And they're trying to make it hard, and Twitter will make it very hard, because if you do not do that, they will say, oh, well, we can't tell if you're a bot or not, so we're going to deboost your account.
That's what Jordan Peterson is trying to push.
Yeah, because he was meeting with Netanyahu.
That was a tough look.
All of that stuff. And the guy that's, like I said, is running this stuff for the WEF is a career Israeli intelligence guy that used to run, like, Netanyahu's cyber policy.
Fuck.
So, like, yeah, that's why they're pushing it. They want a regulated internet. Where they know not just what you're posting online, but what you're reading online.
Yeah.
I mean, they want to be able to legally link all of that to your ID. And when they have the system set up, the idea is to have it seamlessly connected also to, like, your money, your, like, tokens or CBDC my food stamps. Because it's not just going to be a CBDC in the U.S. That's another play that's happening here where, like, you have Ron DeSantis being like, no, CBDCs, and Trump being like, I'll never have a CBDC. If you look at what the Fed has actually said about a CBDC, they never plan to do a CBDC in the U.S. anyway. They're going to have dollar peg stable coins issued by Wall Street banks that are just as programmable and surveillable, but it's not going to be called a CBDC. And they're going to be like, victory for the U.S. Yeah. We have Freedom Coin or AmeriCoin or something like this. And actually, Jared Kushner was pushing for the creation of something that was called USDC before the actual stablecoin USDC existed, to Steve Mnuchin being like, we should make something like this.
Yeah, I kind of remember Catherine Austin Fitz or something I watched talking about the IMF was pushing for a rainbow currency.
Yeah.
It was some kind of like...
Climate coin also was pitched as being IMF. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So what's another red line?
Created it so that the digital ID thing is... All the data in the world for digital IDs, they're going to frame it as like all these private companies, but it's all going to be interoperable. And all that data is going to be exported to the same centralized database that's the most likely candidate for that database has already been made by the World Bank. It's called ID40. And the World Bank is also making climate wallets that interface with all of that for the global carbon market that they're trying to usher in.
So
which Larry Fink's whole like tokenize everything revolution is.
Yeah, like we're little Sonics.
Fuck.
Yeah, like so you don't connect your social media, and then what else do you think? Anything else?
I definitely think developing support networks at the local level, because the government is not going to come save anybody.
Like a militia?
You know what I mean? Like assuming like, oh, as long as we get the right guy in the White House, he's going to make everything better. Like that is the most losing strategy ever, dude. You know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think the best thing to do is try and protect your money by putting it into real physical things that will help you, that you will need when shit hits the fan.
Right.
You know, whether that's land, whether that's supplies, I don't know. It's up to you. Also, they're going to censor the internet more than they ever have. And they're, you know, whatever the cyber attack thing they do, if they do it, it'll probably like take down the internet for a while, or the, you know, they'll make it so like, oh, you can't get onto the internet unless you do the digital ID thing.
Yeah.
Right.
You know? And if you don't want to do the digital ID thing, then you won't have access to the internet anymore. So anything you think you might need on the internet that you can save offline, save it, back it up.
Yeah. I just got a printer.
Whether it's like eBooks, YouTube library, or like ripped YouTube video libraries of like skills or like, you know, knowledge, whatever. Like I have kids, for example. So I've like backed up a bunch of like offline, like kid videos, and like have a, like an entertainment library for them and like educational stuff, like ebook textbooks for like, you know, learning about all sorts of different like shit for high school or like middle school or whatever, just like having that backed up, you know, and then like stuff I'm interested in, you know, I used to like manage farms and stuff, so I have a pretty good knowledge base for like growing food, but like there's a lot of like homesteading skills that like I'm not really well versed in, but I can like download or buy or whatever a bunch of offline media telling me how to use those skills, and they'll be accessible when I need them. Because I'm not doing the digital ID thing, because in my opinion,
I can't do it either.
They're going to make it very hard not to accept it. But the problem is, if you accept it, you're like, oh, I'm just going to use it for a little bit and then get out. That's going to be really hard to do.
Yeah.
You know, once you're in pretty much. It's like one of those things where like it's a fork in the road. Right.
Yes.
And you have to pick which side you go. But it's also a slippery slope, you know. And so like once you start going down the slippery slope, it gets harder and harder to get back up.
Right.
The farther down you go, you know what I mean? So it's best not to go down it at all, you know?
Well, I think I put a 1 foot down the slippery slope with that bullshit ID me stuff from the IRS, and I don't remember if I fucking put my ID in, but if I did, guys, I'll miss you.
Well, I mean, like, the ultimate goal here as far as online stuff goes, it's to eliminate, they want to eliminate online privacy, specifically financial privacy, and that's why they want to, like, make all the dollars digital, because they don't want you to have cash anymore. So, like, that's true when people talk about the CBDC as being, like, programmable and surveillable, but it's not the only currency they can roll out that's programmable and surveillable. Yeah? So, like, if it's not issued by the Fed, it can still be programmable and surveillable.
Thank you.